All right, this video is on exponential functions. Should be a pretty fun video here. First off, what is an exponential function? Exponential function is a function that grows by a percentage. So there are two scenarios that I'm going to use to help you understand exactly what an exponential does and how it differs from a regular linear function. So we have two businesses. They both have 100 stores at the beginning. Business A expands by opening 50 new stores every single year. Business B expands by increasing the number of stores by 50% of their total each year. So A is going up by 50 new stores every year. B is going up by 50% of their total stores each year. So here's a little chart outlining what's happening. In year one, A has 100 and so does B. Easy to understand. In year one, after 1 year, A is going to add 50 stores. So they now have a grand total of 150. B is going to add 50% of what they have. So they have 100 stores plus 0.5, 50%, as a decimal is 0.5. So 50% of 100 is 50. So we're going to add on and get 150 new stores. So in the first year, both increased by 50. But in year two, once again, A just added 50 new stores. They're going to add 50 new stores every year to get 200 stores, whereas B is going to take what they have currently. They currently have 150, and they're going to add 50% of what they have. So 50% of 150 will give us a grand total of 225. That's a 75-store increase. So they increased by 50 the first year, 75 the next year. Year three, A is going to add, once again, add 50 new stores, so they now have a grand total of 250. B is going to add 50% of their total, so their total is currently 225, and they're going to add 50% of 225, which is 112.5, so they have now 337.5 total stores. Since it's the number of stores, you could round that to 338. Now, the idea here is a linear function. You go up by the same amount every time, up 50, up 50, up 50. If I were to continue this, I'd continue to go up 50 every single year, whereas B, their amount that they're increasing by changes. It goes up 50, then it goes up 75, then it goes up 112.5, then it's going to go up even more, and then up even more. And that's because we're increasing by a percentage every time. So the difference between a linear and an exponential function is linear increases by the same amount, whereas exponential increases by an increasing amount, if that makes sense. So let's simplify some of those calculations, because what we want to do is we want to turn it into a formula. And to do that, we want to think about how these calculations are created. So the first year, we took 100 stores and we added 50% of 100. So that's, if I look at that, pretty easy there. Now I have two terms. I have 100 plus 100 times 0.5. I could just change the order. What I'm going to do is I'm going to factor out 100. If I factor out 100 from these two terms, I get 100 times 1 plus 0.5. If I distribute that 100, I would get 100 plus 100 times 0.5, exactly what I did. And that equals 150. Now, year two, I'm going to take 150, the current stores I have, and I'm going to add 50% of 150. Well, once again, factor out 150. If I factor out 150 from each of these two terms, I get 150 times 1 plus 0.5. Once again, distribute 150 times 1, you get 150. 150 times 0.5 is 150 times 0.5. So, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually expand that, because where did this 150 come from? We call that 150 came from what happened year one, which was 100 times 1 plus 0.5. So the 150 was generated by 100 times 1 plus 0.5 times, for the next year, another 1 plus 0.5, which is 100 times 1 plus 0.5 squared, or 225. The third year, I now take 225 stores, and I'm going to add 50% of that. Once again, factor out that 225, and I get 225 times 1 plus 0.5. But where did that 225 come from? That 225 came from everything right above it, up here, which was 100 times 1.5 times 1 plus 0.5 squared, times this other 1 plus 0.5, which makes 100 times 1 plus 0.5 cubed, or 337.5 stores. So an equation I could build for the number of businesses B would be 100 times 1 plus 0.5 raised to the T, where T is the number of years. So hopefully this makes a lot of sense, how I was able to generate this formula by just looking back at what I did and reusing it. So the idea is I'm starting off with 100, I'm adding 1 plus 6.5. That's my increase of 50%. So I'm always going to have at least as many stores as I had the previous year. That's the one. And I'm increasing by 50%. And then T is the number of years up there. So this allows us to understand an exponential growth or exponential decay formula. Here is the formula for exponential growth or decay. It is f of x equals a times 1 plus r raised to the x, where a is the initial value or your starting point. A is what you had in the initial value where you're starting. R is the percent growth or decay as a decimal. So you could be growing or decaying. If you're growing, if you're decaying, then you're going down, obviously, so we would subtract. So be careful, that'd be a subtraction sign if you're going to decay. Now, some people like to change the formula and write it like this: a times b raised to the x. Now, you are certainly more than welcome to do that if you allow b to equal 1 plus r. Obviously, I'm just substituting in 1 plus r for b. Now, the idea is, this is important to understand, because obviously 1 plus r is a number. We could add 1 plus my rate. Just like in the previous problem, I could have said 1.5 instead of writing 1 plus 0.5. Well, that number b, 1 plus r, is known as your growth factor. And that growth factor must be positive, okay? So understand that if you're larger than 1, you're going to grow. If you're smaller than 1, you're going to decay, but it still has to be positive. So for example, if I had a growth factor of 0.63, that means I'm actually decaying, right? Because 1 minus 0.37 would be 0.63, so I'm decaying by 37%. So we'll look at a problem like that a little bit here. So make sure you understand these two formulas. This one in orange is kind of the more popular one because it just uses A and B, but as long as you understand where that B comes from, pretty easy. All right, here's an example of what these two graphs look like. A linear graph is the one here, which says linear, and that is the company A. Remember, company A was going up 50 every single year. That's a constant rising linear function. Whereas the company B over here, they were growing, and they were growing slowly at first, and then as the years ticked by, their growth increases exponentially. It's getting bigger and bigger and bigger. The domain of an exponential function is negative infinity to infinity. You can plug in any value you want. When you plug in negatives, you just get smaller. Think of it like that. Remember, a value raised to the negative, right, 2 to the negative 2, that makes 1 over 2 squared, which is 1/4, right? So when you raise yourself to a negative power, you don't become negative, you just become smaller, which is why on this side of the graph, where we're looking at negatives, right, negatives are on this side of the graph is decaying. It's getting smaller and smaller and smaller. It's not getting bigger, but it's never going to get below 0. It's always going to stay above 0. So we do have a horizontal asymptote at 0. You're never going to cross down and have the function become negative. All right, what I want to do now is look at several examples and understand how we could use that formula I showed you on that previous slide there, how to solve these problems. So in 2008, India's population was 1.14 billion. The population has been increasing by 1.34% each year since 2008. Sorry for the typo there. I want you to create a growth function and find the population in 2020. So the first thing we need is A. A is what we were initially. Initially, we had 1.14 billion people in India. Let's see. R is my growth rate. My growth rate is 1.34%, but I must have that as a decimal, so 0.0134. And finally, that means B is 1 plus my growth rate. So B is 1.0134. So this is my growth rate. That's the 1.34%. This is my growth factor. So a slight difference in verb there, or in vocabulary there, but hopefully you understand that. So my function will be A, 1.14, times my growth factor, 1.0134. raised to the X. And I always want you to make sure you tell me what X is. X is years since 2008. I don't know where I got 19 from. Since 2008. That is very important. This is since 2008. So if I plug in 0, the beginning, 2008, I will get 1.14 billion, which is what it was in 2008. And then every year after that, it's going to increase. So to answer the question, what is the population going to be in 2020? My X value would be 12, because 2020 is 12 years after 2008. So that means I'm going to plug in 12 for X. And 12 years later, what will I get? Well, I'm going to go ahead and show you how to use your calculator here. I get 1.14, and in parentheses, 1.0134. Oh, I forgot a parenthesis there, sorry. parentheses. Okay, I just messed the whole thing up. Let me just restart. 1.14. And then in parentheses, I have 1.0134. And I'm going to raise that to the 12th power. And I get about 1.337 billion people in 2020. So 1.337 billion, don't forget to tag on the word billion, will be the estimated population in India in 2020. All right, let's take out another problem here. A certificate of deposit is called a CD. Maybe you've never heard this before, but a CD is a type of savings account typically offering a higher interest rate in return for a fixed length of time you leave your money invested. So basically, you give the bank some money, they'll hold on to it for a while, and the fact that you're not allowed to touch it means that they'll give you more interest. If a bank offers a 60-month CD with an annual interest rate of 1.2% compounded monthly, how much will a $1,000 investment grow to over those 60 months? So, first off, let's talk about A. A is your initial investment. That is the $1,000. Let's talk about your growth rate. Now, the growth rate says it's 1.2%, but that's the annual percentage rate. But it says it's compounded monthly. Now, that's really important because that means that this problem is going by months, which means X is the number of months. Every single month, the bank is going to compound your interest. So the growth rate was 1.2, which is 0.012, right, as a decimal. However, I do have to divide that up by 12. The reason why I have to divide that by 12 is because there's 12 months in a year, and that is 1.2% is the annual rate. Annual means every year. So that means that that's going to be divided by 12, and I get 0.001. So just so you know, 0.012 divided by 12 is where I'm getting 0.001 from. Hopefully that makes sense. Again, it's an annual percentage rate, but I'm compounding monthly, so I got to divide it up by 12. So my formula for how much money I have is going to be the $1,000 times 1 plus 0.001, and that's going to be my growth factor, B. I guess I could have done that over here as well. Your growth factor is simply 1 plus your rate, which is going to be 1.001. That's very easy. Raised to X. And again, always tell me what X is. X is the number of months. Okay? Very, very important that you understand in every problem what X represents. So, if I want to figure out how much I have after 60 months, I simply take $1,000. 1.001 is my growth factor, and raise it to the 60. So, using my calculator, 1,000 times 1.001 raised to the 60 months is gives me $1,061. $1,061.80. So if I leave this money in the bank completely untouched for 60 months, the bank will give me back $1,061.80, which means I made a profit of $61.80. Pretty easy problem to understand. The only tricky thing here is being careful that you take your annual interest rate and divide it by 12, since I'm compounding it monthly. All right, let's take a look at a decay problem here. So bismuth 210 is an isotope that radioactively decays by about 13% each day. What that means is that 13% of the remaining bismuth 210 decays each day. So each day, this element loses 13% of its weight. So if you begin with 100 milligrams of bismuth 210, how much remains after 1 week? Okay, so A is always how much you have in the beginning. I start off with 100 milligrams. My decay rate is 13%. Now, since I'm decaying, that means my growth factor is going to be 1 minus 0.13. So I'm decaying. My growth rate was 0.13 or 13%, but I'm decaying. I'm going down. So that's why I'm subtracting that. And if I do 1 minus 0.13, I get 0.87. So that means that I'm retaining 87% of what I have. Because I'm losing 13%, I'm retaining 87%. I'm not gaining, I'm retaining, if hopefully that makes sense. So now my function is very easy to create. It's simply going to be 100 times 0.87, that's my growth factor, raised to the X. One more time, what is X? X is the number of days, because remember it says that I'm decaying 13% each day. So if I want to figure out how much I have in a week, I'm going to take 100. Times it by 0.87, 1 week is equal to 7 days. Everybody knows that. 100 times 0.87 raised to the 7 days is 37.73 milligrams. 37.73 milligrams. So I started off with 100 milligrams, but I lose a little bit every day, and I lose a little bit more and more and more and more every day because I'm decaying exponentially. So after 7 days, I will be down to 37.73 milligrams. All right, now, trickier problems involve finding an exponential equation without knowing the growth factor or percentage. This is a problem. So why did the last couple problems become so easy? Because I told you the initial amount and I told you the growth factor. Well, if I don't give you those two things, life becomes a little bit tricky. So let me teach you how to do one of these trickier problems. So you are going to be given 2 points. So I'm going to be telling you 2 points on that exponential model, and you need to come up with the equation. Here's an example. So the 2 points I'm telling you are 4,900 and 9,1044. So first, let's make sure we write down our formula. Our formula for an exponential function is a times b to the x. The problem is, I don't know a, I don't know b. However, I do have an x and a y, and I have another x and y. So let me use both of these. So the first one would be 900 equals a times b to the fourth. So I'm pretending I know a and I know b. If I plug in 4, I should get 900. Problem is, I don't know a and I don't know b. And I could do the exact same thing with the other equation. 1,044 equals a times b raised to the ninth. Again, if I plug in 9, I should get 1,044. So now I have to use these two equations to solve for the two unknowns, a and b. And it's actually really, really easy to do. First thing is I'm going to solve for a. So 900 divided by b to the fourth is a. And I'm going to rewrite that to make it a little bit easier to use. I'm going to write that as 900b to the negative fourth. If you remember anything about exponents, if you're on the bottom, you can move to the top with the negative exponent. If you're on the top, you can move to the bottom with the negative exponent. So 900b to the negative 4 is a. Now I'm going to come over to my other equation and plug that in. So I'm going to take the 1044, but instead of a, I'm going to write 900 times b to the negative 4 times b to the ninth. So I just replaced a with what I solved for it on the other side. So that means I get 1044 divided by 900 equals b to the fifth. Now, I was using one of my rules of exponents. My rules of exponents says if you have the same base, b and b, you can add those two exponents. 9 and negative 4 adds up to 5. Now, how do I solve for b? Well, hopefully you guys remember this back in Algebra 2. Just raise it to the 1/5 power. To get rid of a fifth root, or to get rid of a fifth power, you need to use a 1/5 power or a fifth root. So I'm going to raise this side to 1/5 as well. Be careful when you go to your calculator here. Make sure you just use parentheses. I'm going to put in parentheses 1044 divided by 900. And I'm going to raise that and then in parentheses 1/5. Okay? And I get 1.03 as my b values. Let's come back over here. 1.03 is my b value. I guess I could have kept a little bit more decimals there, but we'll just keep 2 decimals for right now. Actually, you know what? Might as well go and keep 4 decimals. 1.031, just for accuracy purposes, it couldn't hurt. 1.0301 is my b value. Now remember, b is 1 plus r. That means b would be 1 plus 0.0301, right? Pretty obvious to see that. That means I was growing by about 3.01%. That was my growth rate for this particular problem. But anyway, I got B, which is half the battle, so I have the B value. All I got to do is find A. Well, guess what? I got a formula right over here that tells me how to find A. So if I do 900 times that B value I just found, 1.0301, raised to the negative 4, I should get A. So I'm going to come back over to calculator, 900 times my new B value, 1.0301, raised to the negative 4. I should get my initial value, which is 799.3279. So 799.3279, 799.3279. That is my A value. So very, very simple to find both values. So my initial amount must have been around 800, it's about 799.3279, and my growth rate was about 3.01%, which caused me to have a growth factor of 1.0301. So my final equation, my final function would be A, 799.3279, times b, 1.0301, sorry for being tight over here at the end of my screen, raised to the x. So very, very simple. So I have a second one for you to try on your own, so I would highly recommend you pausing the video right now, trying it out on your own, and whenever you're ready to hit play, you could determine what the answer is by watching me. So go ahead and hit pause now, do it on your own, come back. All right, so the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to generate two equations. This equation would be 3 equals a times b to the first. This equation would be 10.125 equals a times b to the fourth. Solve this equation for a, so I'm going to do 3 divided by b to the first equals a, which is 3 times b to the negative 1. Just makes it a little bit easier when you don't have the fraction. So now I'm going to come back over here, 10.125, and I'm going to substitute 3b to the negative 1 in for a, and then don't forget your b to the fourth. So I'm going to divide both sides by 3, so 10.125 divided by 3 equals b to the third. Again, negative 1 plus 4 is b to the third. So let's see here, 10.125 divided by 3 is 3.375. Well, let me raise it to the 1/3, I guess, first. So raise this to the 1/3 power. That's how you get rid of a cubed, is raising it to the 1/3. That's going to get me b. So let's see, 10.125 divided by 3 raised to the 1/3 power gives me, wow, this is nice, and exactly 1.5 for b. Exactly 1.5. So now I'm going to come back over here and do 3 times 1.5 raised to the negative 1 to solve for a. So 3 times 1.5 raised to the negative 1 is 2. Well, that worked out really nice. A is 2. So I got my a, I got my b. Now I'm ready to make my formula. The function is my initial amount, 2 times 1.5 to the x. So my initial amount is 2. My growth rate must have been 0.5 because b is 1 plus 0.5, or 1.5, which means my growth rate was 50% and my initial value was 2. So hopefully pretty easy problems there. Hopefully you were able to see how to do that one. And when you come to class, we'll do a whole bunch of practice just with these problems.